Les Miserables by Victor Hugo. Book 2, The Fall. Chapter 6, Jean Valjean. Towards the middle of the night, Jean Valjean woke. Jean Valjean came from a poor peasant family of Brie. He had not learned to read in his childhood. When he reached man's estate, he became a tree pruner at Faverolles. His mother was named Jean Metu. His father was called Jean Valjean, or Valjean, probably a sobriquet, and a contraction of Voilà Jean. Here's Jean. Jean Valjean was of that thoughtful but not gloomy disposition which constitutes the peculiarity of affectionate natures. On the whole, however, there was something decidedly sluggish and insignificant about Jean Valjean, in appearance at least. He had lost his father and mother at a very early age. His mother had died of a milk fever, which had not been properly attended to. His father, a tree pruner like himself, had been killed by a fall from a tree. All that remained to Jean Valjean was a sister older than himself, a widow with 7 children, boys and girls. This sister had brought up Jean Valjean, and so long as she had had a husband, she lodged and fed her young brother. The husband died. The eldest of the 7 children was 8 years old, the youngest 1. Jean Valjean had just attained his 25th year. He took the father's place, and in his turn supported the sister who had brought him up. This was done simply as a duty, and even a little churlishly on the part of Jean Valjean. Thus his youth had been spent in rude and ill-paid toil. He had never known a kind woman friend in his native parts. He had not had the time to fall in love. He returned at night weary, and ate his broth without uttering a word. His sister, Mother Jean, often took the best part of his repast from his bowl while he was eating, a bit of meat, a slice of bacon, the heart of the cabbage, to give to one of her children. As he went on eating, with his head bent over the table and almost into his soup, his long hair falling about his bowl and concealing his eyes, he had the air of perceiving nothing and allowing it. There was at Faverolles, not far from the Valjean-thatched cottage, on the other side of the lane, a farmer's wife named Marie-Claude. The Valjean children, habitually famished, sometimes went to borrow from Marie-Claude a pint of milk in their mother's name, which they drank behind a hedge or in some alley corner, snatching the jug from each other so hastily that the little girls spilled it on their aprons and down their necks. If their mother had known of this marauding, she would have punished the delinquent severely. Jean Valjean gruffly and grumblingly played Marie-Claude for the pint of milk behind their mother's back, and the children were not punished. In pruning season he earned 18 sous a day. Then he hired out as a haymaker, as laborer, as neatherd on a farm, as a drudge. He did whatever he could. His sister worked also, but what could she do with 7 little children? It was a sad group enveloped in misery, which was being gradually annihilated. A very hard winter came. Jean had no work. The family had no bread. No bread, literally. 7 children. One Sunday evening, Maubert Isabeau, the baker on the church square at Faverolles, was preparing to go to bed, when he heard a violent blow on the grated front of his shop. He arrived in time to see an arm passed through the hole made by a blow from a fist, through the grating and the glass. The arm seized a loaf of bread and carried it off. Isabeau ran out in haste. The robber fled at the full speed of his legs. Isabeau ran after him and stopped him. The thief had flung away the loaf, but his arm was still bleeding. It was Jean Valjean. This took place in 1795. Jean Valjean was taken before the tribunals of the time for theft and breaking and entering an inhabited house at night. He had a gun which he had used better than anyone else in the world. He was a bit of a poacher, and this injured his case. There exists a legitimate prejudice against poachers. The poacher, like the smuggler, smacks too strongly of the brigand. Nevertheless, we will remark cursorily, there is still an abyss between these races of men and the hideous assassin of the towns. The poacher lives in the forest, the smuggler lives in the mountains or on the sea. The cities make ferocious men because they make corrupt men. The mountain, the sea, the forest make savage men. They develop the fierce side, but often without destroying the humane side. Jean Valjean was pronounced guilty. The terms of the code were explicit. There occur formidable hours in our civilization. There are moments when the penal laws decree a shipwreck. What an ominous minute is that in which society draws back and consummates the irreparable abandonment of a sentient being. Jean Valjean was condemned to 5 years in the galleys. On the 22nd of April, 1796, the victory of Montauban, won by the general-in-chief of the army of Italy, whom the message of the directory to the 500, of the 2nd of Floréal, year 4, calls Buonaparte, was announced in Paris. On that same day, a great gang of galley-slaves was put in chains at Bicêtre. Jean Valjean formed a part of that gang. An old turnkey of the prison, who is now nearly 80 years old, still recalls perfectly that unfortunate wretch who was chained to the end of the fourth line, in the north angle of the courtyard. He was seated on the ground like the others. He did not seem to comprehend his position, except that it was horrible. It is probable that he also was disentangling from amid the vague ideas of a poor man, ignorant of everything, something excessive. While the bolt of his iron collar was being riveted behind his head with heavy blows from the hammer, he wept. His tears stifled him. They impeded his speech. He only managed to say from time to time, "I was a tree pruner at Faverolles." Then, still sobbing, he raised his right hand and lowered it gradually 7 times, as though he were touching in succession 7 heads of unequal heights. And from this gesture it was divined that the thing which he had done, whatever it was, had been done for the sake of clothing and nourishing 7 little children. He set out for Toulon. He arrived there, after a journey of 27 days, on a cart with a chain on his neck. At Toulon he was clothed in the red cassock. All that had constituted his life, even to his name, was effaced. He was no longer even Jean Valjean. He was number 24,601. What became of his sister? What became of the 7 children? Who troubled himself about that? What becomes of the handful of leaves from the young tree which is sawed off at the root? It is always the same story. These poor living beings, these creatures of God, henceforth without support, without guide, without refuge, wandered away at random. Who even knows, each in his own direction, perhaps, and little by little buried themselves in that cold mist which engulfs solitary destinies, gloomy shades into which disappear in succession so many unlucky heads, in the somber march of the human race. They quitted the country. The clock tower of what had been their village forgot them. The boundary line of what had been their field forgot them. After a few years' residence in the galleys, Jean Valjean himself forgot them. In that heart, where there had been a wound, there was a scar. That is all. Only once, during all the time which he spent at Toulon, did he hear his sister mentioned. This happened, I think, towards the end of the 4th year of his captivity. I know not through what channels the news reached him. Someone who had known them in their own country had seen his sister. She was in Paris. She lived in a poor street, Rue Saint-Sulpice, in the Rue de Gendre. She had with her only 1 child, a little boy, the youngest. Where were the other 6? Perhaps she did not know herself. Every morning she went to a printing office, No. 3, Rue de Sabot, where she was a folder and stitcher. She was obliged to be there at 6 o'clock in the morning, long before daylight in winter. In the same building with the printing office there was a school, and to this school she took her little boy, who was 7 years old. But as she entered the printing office at 6, and the school only opened at 7, the child had to wait in the courtyard for the school to open for 1 hour, 1 hour of a winter night in the open air. They would not allow the child to come into the printing office, because he was in the way, they said. When the workmen passed in the morning, they beheld this poor little being seated on the pavement, overcome with drowsiness, and often fast asleep in the shadow, crouched down and doubled up over his basket. When it rained, an old woman, the portress, took pity on him. She took him into her den, where there was a pallet, a spinning wheel, and two wooden chairs, and the little one slumbered in a corner, pressing himself close to the cat that he might suffer less from cold. At 7 o'clock the school opened, and he entered. This is what was told to Jean Valjean. They talked to him about it for one day. It was a moment, a flash, as though a window had suddenly been opened upon the destiny of those things whom he had loved. Then all closed again. He heard nothing more forever. Nothing from them ever reached him again. He never beheld them. He never met them again. And in the continuation of this mournful history, they will not be met with any more. Towards the end of this fourth year, Jean Valjean's turn to escape arrived. His comrades assisted him, as is the custom in that sad place. He escaped. He wandered for 2 days in the fields at liberty. If being at liberty is to be hunted, to turn the head every instant, to quake at the slightest noise, to be afraid of everything, of a smoking roof, of a passing man, of a barking dog, of a galloping horse, of a striking clock, of the day because one can see, of the night because one cannot see, of the highway, of the path, of a bush, of sleep. On the evening of the second day he was captured. He had neither eaten nor slept for 36 hours. The Maritime Tribunal condemned him, for this crime, to a prolongation of his term for 3 years, which made 8 years. In the sixth year his turn to escape occurred again. He availed himself of it, but could not accomplish his flight fully. He was missing at roll call. The cannon were fired, and at night the patrol found him hidden under the keel of a vessel in process of construction. He resisted the galley guards who seized him. Escape and rebellion. This case, provided for by a special code, was punished by an addition of 5 years, two of them in the double chain. 13 years. In the 10th year his turn came round again. He again profited by it. He succeeded no better. 3 years for this fresh attempt. 16 years. Finally, I think it was during his 13th year, he made a last attempt, and only succeeded in getting retaken at the end of 4 hours of absence. 3 years for those 4 hours. 19 years. In October 1815 he was released. He had entered there in 1796 for having broken a pane of glass and taken a loaf of bread. Room for a brief parenthesis. This is the second time, during his studies on the penal question and damnation by law, that the author of this book has come across the theft of a loaf of bread as the point of departure for the disaster of a destiny. Claude Gault had stolen a loaf. Jean Valjean had stolen a loaf. English statistics prove the fact that 4 thefts out of 5 in London have hunger for their immediate cause. Jean Valjean had entered the galleys sobbing and shuddering. He emerged impassive. He had entered in despair. He emerged gloomy. What had taken place in that soul? End of Book 2, Chapter 6.